Well, welcome you to the Bible study today. And today we're going to be discussing the universal church versus the local church. And we want to see what the Bible has to say about that. There's a lot of discussion, and there is also a lot of doctrines that I believe are false because they're based on one of these ideas or the other. You have two extremes, the Catholic Church, which believes that it is the universal, all-encompassing Church of God. And then there is ideas put forth like what we would call a Baptist brighter who believes that only the Baptist church is the church. And then there's some folks that say that the local church is all there is to the biblical idea of a church and that there is no connection at all. And so those are differing viewpoints, and I believe they're both incorrect, and I believe that both the universal church and the local church ideas are both correct in some aspect. And so we'll take the Bible and we'll discuss that. I myself am an independent Baptist. I believe in the approach of the independent Baptist churches as far as the way things are set up today. I disagree greatly with a lot of independent Baptist preachers about some of their ideas and some of their theology and even some of their approaches, their mannerisms, the manner of worship. I disagree with greatly, and I'm thankful to live in a country where we have the ability to disagree and to follow our conscience when we read the scripture and preach the scripture and try to bring out some sort of a gospel ministry that we believe matches the Bible. I'm glad we have great latitude in that, but when it comes to God, we don't have great latitude. We must find His will and His direction. And when we get to the judgment seat of Christ, there is going to be no constitution or bill of rights or freedom of religion or any of that stuff. There'll just be God's word, and He will bring up the fact that the Holy Spirit was given to us not to get an interpretation of the Bible, but the interpretation of the Bible. Holy men of old spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So I think it's worth studying. I think it's worth listening to different opinions because that way you can check yourself. You can check what you interpreted the Bible to mean and see if you've been off base a little bit. But ultimately, we have to rely on the scripture with scripture, and we have to get our biblical interpretation that way. So when we talk about a local church and when we talk about a universal church, there are some big issues at stake there. Some things doctrinally that some churches believe are based completely upon what they believe about the church, whether it's universal or whether it's local. And so some of those things are very wrong. And the reason that they're very wrong is they're just based on the wrong set of facts. And that is, again, whether there is a local church only or a universal church only. And so we're going to look at those things. And then let's talk about the word church just a second. The King James translators, they chose to use in the Old Testament the word congregation, which is a great word, and the word church in the New Testament, and that's a great word also. And so one of the foundational arguments in this is, well, should it have been congregation or should it have been church? If you go back to some of the older English translations, you'll find that they used the word congregation in the New Testament, whereas the King James translators only used the word church. And so I believe that basically that is a good decision that the King James translators made when they decided to use the word church, because the word church in the New Testament is always used to relate the idea of God's people. In the Old Testament, certainly the nation of Israel was God's people, but they were also their own people, and they were in the covenant with Abraham, and they're not exactly in the same covenant as folks are in the New Testament. And so when the church is mentioned in the New Testament, they're careful to use the word church, because if you study the word church throughout the New Testament, you'll find that it means only God's people. In other words, sometimes instead of using the word church, Paul uses words like we and us and them, maybe to them or they, to signify folks outside of the church or outside of believers. But when it says we, for example, in Romans chapter 8, when it says we know that all things work together. It's talking about we, the Christians, God's people know that. And so the church knows. And so that'll also clear up some things where you wouldn't be able to say, I am predestinated. But you could say, and the Bible says, we are predestinated. So the predestinated crowd is a group of believers, not an individual. In order to go to heaven, in order to have the possibility of being conformed to the image of God's Son, you must be put into the body, which is the church. And we'll read that here in Ephesians chapter 1 in just a second. But once you are put into the body, then you can say rightfully, we, the church, we, the believers, are predestinated to be conformed to the image of God's Son. So if you wanted to find out if predestination meant predestinated to be saved, which the Bible does not say, but if you wanted to make predestination mean salvation, then you would say we are predestinated to be saved. The Bible just doesn't say that. It says we are predestinated to be conformed to the image of His Son. And so you just ask yourself, am I right now sitting here, and have I been conformed to the image of His Son? And I'll be the first to admit that I do not conform to the image of God's Son in this present state. But as Ephesians chapter 1 says, when the redemption of the purchased possession, the adoption, to wit, the redemption of the body takes place, when that takes place, I will be conformed to the image of His Son, and I am, as a born-again man, predestinated for that. So the issue is your interpretation of who we, the word we, W-E, who we are. We are believers. And so I am a sinner saved by the grace of God, and I did that by faith in His Son, not by predestination. When I got saved, when I become born again, then I was put into a body that is a collection of individual members, but that body collectively is predestinated to be conformed to the image of His Son. So it really does matter how you interpret the word church in the New Testament. It's very important. If we read through the New Testament, it said the congregation, and we interpret the congregation to be a collection of saved people, then we could rightly say, or we could potentially say, that everybody who joined a local church was saved, and that's just not true. You must be born again. So the church, which is His body, Ephesians 1 and Colossians 1 both have that reference. The church, which is His body. The church is an organization. It's a body of only those who are born again, who have been spiritually converted into God's Son, and will be predetermined, predestinated. They have a predetermined destination of becoming conformed to the image of God's Son. So if that wasn't the case, then just the congregation, that could include lost people, people that are under conviction, people that don't care, people are there for social standing. But if you have a church and you meet on Sunday morning, there's lots of people, perhaps a mixed multitude inside that building, but there are only a specific number who have trusted in Christ that are in the church, which is His body. The rest are outside, even though they are a part of the congregation. So it was a very smart move on the part of the King James Bible translators to use the word church, which means the same as congregation, but to use it in a wise manner, because we know that in the Old Testament, where they used the word congregation, oftentimes in Israel, there was a mixed multitude. And so here in Ephesians chapter 1, we find in verse number 21, I pick it up really in the middle of a statement, but it says, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under His feet and gave Him to be the head over all things to the church, which is His body, the fullness of Him that filleth all in all. So Christ is the head of the body, which is the church. Christ is the head of the body, which is the church. Christ is not the head of an organization that passes out food. Christ is not the head of an organization that gives out education, such as a college or any such thing as that. Christ is not the head of a what we call, quote unquote, a gospel mission. Christ is the head over all things to the church, the collection of believers that have assembled themselves together to provoke one another to love and to good works. So hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body. And then Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 18, we'll read verse 17, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist, and he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. So no one denomination makes up the church, but in all denominations, those who are saved are a part of the church. So that leads us to the question, what is the church? Is it a local church, or is it a universal church where everybody's included? And the Catholic Church, as far as Protestants are concerned, or especially Baptists are concerned, the word universal church has been made odious. It's been made to really stink because they claim that they are the only true church and through them only is salvation. Well, it's a double false thing. They are not the only true church and through them is not the only way to attain salvation. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the way, not the churches of the way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says, no man can come to the Father but by him. You don't come to the Father by a church. You come to Christ through the preaching of the gospel, and you come to the Father through the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what am I trying to get at? The Catholic Church has presented the idea of a universal church in the wrong way, and therefore making all non-Catholics or most non-Catholics reject that idea, when the idea is actually only wrong because it's misdefined. The word universal means everything, all-inclusive. And I will say this, that everything is not included in the church. Only believers in the Lord Jesus Christ is included in the body of Christ. If you're not saved, if you're not born again, even to such things as the earth and all this stuff, the Bible says they will flee away and there will be a new heaven and a new earth. Christ redeems sinful men. Once he does that, they're placed into the body of Christ. And I would only say that the universal church is true because all believers are placed into it. And I would also say this, if you ever were saved throughout history from Christ till now, you are still in the body. Paul was a part of the body in his day. Paul is still a part of the body today, and once you die physically, you do not fall out of the body of Christ. So in that sense, the church is universal, only universal bodily, universal in regards to all believers. Everything in the universe, that's far beyond anything that you could prove from your Bible. And especially all professing believers. You couldn't say that all professing believers, but only those that have been born again. And that is a personal relationship. That's a personal thing between you and God the Father. It's not for me to say you're born again or not born again. That's for you and the Lord. That's the Word of God makes it clear how it's done. It's between you and God. Have you done it God's way? So that's not for me to judge, but I can say this. The church, which is his body, has never lost a member, and therefore everyone who has ever been saved is now in the body of Christ. Okay, I think I made that clear enough. Now, as for the local church, Galatians chapter 1 says this. He says, Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren which are with me unto the churches, plural, churches of Galatia. So that just reading that verse makes me think that contrary to Catholic history, the church was not a dwindling minority who had no hope of survival until the complete formation of the what we call today the Catholic Church. Far from that, Christianity was so large in the early days of Christianity that towns were already having multiple churches. And both, let's say in Galatia there was only two. It says churches, indefinite. It's not definitive how many there was. But churches means more than one. So in Paul's day, there was already more than one church in Galatia. And they're both, if there's two, they're both validated because this letter of God's word was addressed to them, not the one, them. It's one body, multiple churches, but it's addressed to them, to the churches of God. They are the church. And so the idea of just one local church or a local church being the church of God and being the body of Christ is ridiculous. It carries a ridiculous tone to it because then you have to say, well, which church is the true church? The one at Rome? If it's the local church only, was it the one at Rome or the one at Galatia? Was it the one at Ephesus? Was it the one at Thyatira? Which one was it? And the answer is it's all of them. And the people who were in those congregations who were born again were made up of the church. There are some people that are saved, I believe, that have fallen out of church and backslidden. They don't go to church anywhere. They're not a member of a church anywhere. But if they are a believer on the Lord Jesus Christ, their state is very bad, but their standing is that they are in Christ. See, over here as well, Philippians chapter number 1, and it defines who is in the church. Philippians chapter 1 and verse number 1, it says, Paul and Timotheus, the servant of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi. So here, instead of using the word church, he uses all the saints in Christ Jesus. Then he tells their geographic location, which are at Philippi. To all the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi, with the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you and peace. So in this case, you get the rare moment when he refers to the people as in Christ rather than a church. And to me, that just scripture with scripture defines who is in the church, all of those who are in Christ. So church is a much safer word than congregation. No one denomination makes up the church. Universal versus local is a matter of what your definition is. Again, I don't believe that everything in the universe or everyone in the universe or everyone in a specific denomination is in the true church. But I do believe that everyone that is in Christ through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, through his shed blood, his death, burial, and resurrection, I believe that all of those, all of them, throughout all of history from the cross till this day, I believe that all of them are a member of the body of Christ, and that is as universal as it can get. No one has ever fallen out of the church. Everyone who has ever been saved is still in the body of Christ, represented in heaven and on earth by the head of the church, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. That is as close to a biblical argument as you can make about this topic. Anything else as far as we're the church that Christ founded and we're the denomination that's closest to the original, all this stuff is just educated man's attempt to justify himself and justify why he's in the denomination or why he's following a specific theological view. All that stuff means nothing until you get the basic biblical definition of what a church is down in your heart. Then you can go from there and see which denomination you think most closely follows the Word of God. And then once I was convinced of that in my own heart, which I am and which I have, I would become a part of that group of believers. No man is under the authority or has a mandate from the Word of God to separate himself from the body of Christ in any way, shape, or form. So there's no biblical mandate for a man to take his family to his house and pretend he's having a church in his house when in fact it's just his family divided from the rest of the believers. And you can have a church in your house all you want to, but it must have bishops and deacons. It must have an outreach program. It must reach the lost. It must preach the gospel into all the world. So those are just, to me, what amounts to semantic arguments. Whether you want to meet in your house or meet in a church building or meet in a tent, whatever you want to do, make sure it's a biblical church. And a biblical church is all of those that have ever been and are now and will be in the future inside the Lord Jesus Christ, in the body of Christ, through faith in his name. That is the biblical idea of the churches. Thanks. Have a good day.